Hi, let's talk about the facial fasciae. In this video, we'll discuss the distribution and relative depths of the facial fasciae. Fasciae is the plural of fascia. You can also say fascias. So the face has many different layers to it. The most superficial of all of these layers, and the one that is going to host hair and other glandular novelties, is the skin. Deep to the skin is quite a mixture of overlaying layers of connective tissues, i.e. fascia, muscles, nerves, glands, and other neurovasculature. Immediately deep to the skin is a subcutaneous thickened fibroadipose layer. It's this very thick and rough fibroadipose layer that the muscles of facial expression act upon and that allow for the face to express emotion. Deep to that comes quite a variety of things to be discussed. So here on the left is a right lateral view of the head and neck with various fascial and musculofascial regions highlighted. So one of the more superficial layers that's largely found anteriorly and inferior on the face is called the superficial musculoapponeurotic system, or the SMAS for short. This SMAS is inclusive of the muscles of facial expression. And here we can see it's encompassing basically everything from the brow on down to the base of the mandible. And posteriorly here, this division with the temporal parietal fascia is good. But I want you to understand that that inferiorly here, there's going to be quite a wide range of overlap between the parotid masseteric fascia, which is in green, and the SMAS. And so typically there's a good bit of overlap here. That parotid masseteric fascia is going to be found deep to the SMAS for most of its region. So let me uncover that. Oops. One of the elements here that we really want to appreciate osteologically is going to be that of the zygomatic arch. It's that zygomatic arch that is going to be one of the attachment sites for the masseter. It's also going to allow the temporal muscle, the temporalis, to descend down and insert on the mandible underneath it. And in this case, that zygomatic arch is an approximate division between the temporal parietal fascia superior and the parotid masseteric fascia inferior to it. So that's where those boundaries exist. Let's start superiorly and work our way down. So the temporoparietal fascia gets its name because it's investing the temporalis, and it's in the region of the temporal bone and overlapping with the parietal bone. In some cases, it can be quite dense, as you may experience in dissection. This temporal parietal fascia is coplanar to the SMAS, so they share a boundary. and they have very little, if any, overlap between them. We may see some overlap on part of orbicularis oculi, that lateral edge of it, and the investing portions of the SMAS there. But for the most part, SMAS and temporal parietal fascia, coplanar. Parotid masseteric fascia is going to largely invest the parotid gland, as its name suggests, and the masseter muscle. That masseter muscle is going to be anterior to the parotid gland. Well, at least part of it will be anterior to the parotid gland. Part of it will be deep to the parotid gland. In some areas, again, like around the parotid gland, this parotid masseteric fascia can be extraordinarily dense. There's a lot of disagreement in the literature regarding these fascial layers, and even regarding the names of these fascial layers. So, for instance, the parotid masseteric fascia is sometimes referred to as the parotidio masseteric fascia. Here we call it what it's typically referred to, the parotid masseteric fascia. And again, it's inferior to the zygomatic arch, and it's largely going to be deep to the SMAS. So in understanding various layers here, it's probably also good to understand that for the bulk of their journey, and recall these branches are going to emerge from the stylomastoid foramen, usually as divisions, and then they branch outwards. But for the bulk of their journey, these branches are going through the body of the parotid gland, and therefore deep to the parotid masseteric fascia. They continue distally, and they generally remain deep to these fascial layers, but as they move more distally, they begin to move more superficially. So they will transcend these tissue layers as they go outwards. One other thing to to bring to your attention. So here is, we can see a little bit of the infraorbital, or the canine space that's deep to this. We also have the buccal space, which is going to be deep here. There's a large buccal fat pad there. You got the parotid duct coming across as well. And the floor of this buccal space is going to be the buccinator muscle, the muscle of the cheek. And that's going to be invested by buccopharyngeal fascia. That buccopharyngeal fascia invests the buccinator muscle, as well as a large part of the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle, and even the middle pharyngeal constrictor muscle as well. And so that buccopharyngeal fascia is deep, not as deep as the buccinator muscle, but it's going to be the floor of that buccal space. And that leads us to our assessment question, and that is, in areas where the parotid masseteric fascia, the PMF, overlaps with the SMAS, what relationship does the PMF have to the SMAS? PMF is anterior to the SMAS? Nope. SMAS is certainly generally more anterior to PMF. PMF is deep to the SMAS. Yeah, that sounds good to me right now. They do overlap for most of their distribution, and the SMAS is superficial to PMF. So I like that answer. Let's see if there's a better one to be had. PMF is inferior to SMAS? No, PMF is superficial to SMAS. Nope, that's not even ballpark correct. And then PMF is superior to SMAS. No, that is incorrect. So the correct and only answer, B, PMF is deep to the SMAS. Thank you very much for your time.